Afternoon, friends. Isn't it wonderful that on a beautiful day like this we can come together to praise God, to worship Him, and to study His Word. So I hope you've got your Bibles, because we're going to have a look at a very... Okay, that's all I need. No need to. We're going to study a fascinating passage of Scripture together. You know, friends, every time I come to Fountain, I am reminded of the challenge that we have of reaching Sydney, the heart of Sydney, for Jesus. And that's why we're here. We are here to fly the flag for Jesus, to share His love with the people who live in downtown Sydney and come here to work. You know, every day, hundreds of thousands of people come here to the heart of Sydney. And the vast majority of those people don't know Jesus. Friends, Jesus has said, before He comes back, each one of those people must have an opportunity to hear the good news of Jesus and be able to respond and prepare for His soon coming. And that's why we're here. The Lord has placed us here for that purpose. So friends, it's something that hits me every time I come into the city, and I want to say thank you to the Lord for providing us with this opportunity and this location to have a base here for the Lord Jesus Christ. Let's look for opportunities to share, to invite people, to bring them along to the programs that are being conducted. Before I begin, I'm going to ask the Lord to be with us once again. Let's just bow our heads. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you for your love and your goodness to us, for your many blessings. Thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day that reminds us of your love, your power. And Lord, as we come together to worship, to open your word, we invite your presence to be here with us. Bless us now as we worship, for we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
When we were filming a series of programs in India, it soon became clear as you travel through India that it's such a colourful, vibrant nation. More people in India than in any other country on earth. And it's full of colour, it's full of vibrancy, full of wonderful, wonderful, wonderful people. But not just locations and people, but also culture and stories. And one of the stories we were reminded of while we were there, we were filming a program on Art for Eyes for India, for basically a ministry to provide the gift of sight to the blind. And I was reminded of that story, I'm sure you've all heard it, of the six blind men. And the king brought them into the palace, and he wanted them to describe an elephant. Now remember, they couldn't see. So each of the six blind men were placed next to a particular part of the anatomy of that elephant. And so one was holding the trunk, and he was asked to describe another, the tusk, the ear, the leg, the side of the elephant, and the tail. So here are these blind, can't see a thing, never seen an elephant before. And they are led in, and they are given this portion of the elephant, and then they're asked to define it, to describe it. So, of course, the one who was holding the leg, he said, the king said, how do you describe an elephant? And he said, oh, it must look like a pillar. And the one who was holding the tail, he said, oh, what's an elephant like? Well, it must be like a long rope. And then the man who held the trunk, he said, ooh, an elephant. How do I describe it? It must be like a snake. And then the one who had the ear said, well, it must be like a big hand fan. And then the one who was describing the elephant based on his feeling of the tusk said, an elephant. Oh, it must be like a spear. Reminds us of what it must be like to be blind. You know, in India, there are 15 million blind people. What's the population of Australia? 22 million? Imagine about two-thirds of the population of Australia all blind. And like those six blind men, they have a very limited exposure to life and to what is taking place around them. So here in India, there are 15 million blind people feeling their way through life without being able to see. Because why? Our eyes are one of the most critical organs of our bodies. Can you imagine for a moment what life would be like without sight? How would you know where to sit here? You have no idea of what was on the screen up here. How would you recognize the people sitting next to you? How would you know what your surroundings are like? You see, friends, without sight, life is a living hell. Because if you are blind, you are totally dependent on someone else if you move outside your immediate environment. Because 80% of all we perceive as humans comes through our eyes. Think about that for a moment. About half of our brain is involved in the seeing process.
a reminder that we as human beings are visual creatures, are we not? Of all the senses, sight is probably the most precious. Imagine if you were told, look, you're going to have to give up one of your senses. Or imagine if you were told you can keep one of your senses. For many of us, that one would be our sight. Isn't that right? Because we are so dependent on our sight. Now, friends, the eye, the human eye, is one of the most fascinating and complex parts of the body. The eye is actually a marvel. Evolution cannot explain the eye. It's just too fantastic to have evolved by chance. Just consider this. Your eye can process 36,000 bits of information in an hour. Your eye can focus on about 50 things in a single second. We have wonderful cameras that we can purchase today. The new 4K, they tell me they're making 8K cameras now. Brilliant. But friends, they are no match for the human eye. Your eye can detect 10 million different color hues. Just think about that. Take one shade, take one of the most perhaps uninteresting colours or shade. Take grey. Your eye can distinguish 500 shades of grey. But without sight, life loses much of its pleasure and its meaning. And so you can understand why, when Jesus was here, he paid a lot of attention to blind people. Listen to what he said. He's now explaining the reason that he came to this planet. All right? Jesus explains to us why he came. I want you to notice what he said. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me. Now, here he is. This is what he's come to do. This is his mission. Because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom to the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Do you notice? One of the main reasons that Jesus came here to this earth was to provide the recovery of sight to the blind. You can understand why. Sight is so important to our happiness, to our well-being, to our very survival. So you can understand, one of the reasons Jesus came was to provide sight for the blind, to give them the gift of sight. And so for us as a Christian ministry, it is written, one of our major projects is to work to provide the gift of sight to people who are blind. That's why we have one of our major projects based in India for that very purpose. We believe, friends, that it's part of God's plan for us as a Christian ministry. Because when Jesus was here, he spent a lot of time and work and activity involved with dealing with blind people. In fact, the gospel contains 6 stories of Jesus giving sight to the blind. Now, 3 of them are probably the same event, so that makes 4 different miracles recorded of Jesus healing that specifically focus on Jesus healing the blind people. And friends, Jesus used many ways to heal these blind people. I want you to read probably one of the most interesting, found in the book of Mark chapter 8. They came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. And notice what Jesus does. If you want to look up your Bibles, Mark chapter 8. This is a fabulous miracle. Mark chapter 8, and it's found in verses 22 to 26. So notice what he does now. They bring this blind man to Jesus, and they say, Jesus, please, just touch him. That's what Jesus does. He took the man by the hand and he led him outside the village. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, Do you see anything? Now listen to the man's response. He looked up and said, I see people, but they look like trees. They look like trees walking around. Once more, Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes. Then his eyes were what? Were opened. His eyes were opened. His sight was restored. And he saw everything how? Clearly. He saw everything clearly. Now, friends, there are a number of unusual facts about this miracle. Firstly, it's recorded only in the Gospel of Mark. Now, the reason that that's fascinating is that about 80 to 90% of the book of Mark is also found in Matthew and Luke. Remember, the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, are eyewitness accounts of the life and ministry of Jesus. And so you can imagine you've got four people telling what they saw when they were with Jesus. And so when Mark tells it, 80% of his content is also included in Matthew and Luke. But this miracle of Jesus healing this blind man at Bethsaida, only found. It's one of that small segment of the book of Mark that is unique to Mark. Not found anywhere else. So that makes it a unique miracle. It's recorded only in the Gospel of Mark. It's the only time that Jesus ever spat on someone. You remember what it said? Mm-hmm. Jesus came out, took him by the hand, took him outside the village, and then he spat on him. Spat on his eyes. The only time we have recorded of Jesus ever spitting on someone. It's the only time Jesus ever heals someone in stages. You notice he healed him first. He said, can you see anything? And he said, yeah, look, I can see people out there, but they look like trees moving around. So what did Jesus do then? He came back and he touched him this time. And then he said, now I can see. I can see clearly. So this is the only miracle where Jesus heals someone in stages. Now think about that for a moment. Why does Jesus choose to heal this man in stages? Do you think he could have healed him first time? Do you think so? Yeah. Listen, friends, this is the Jesus who created this world, who spoke and it was so. Isn't that right? Who spoke this world into existence. This is the Jesus who raised the dead with just a word. This is the Jesus who healed people with just a touch. So could he have healed this blind man? Straight off? What do you think?
Absolutely.
So why then does he choose to heal this man in stages? Well, friends, remember this, that blind people cannot see the light. Isn't that right? For them, everything is dark. They live in a world of darkness. Everything is black. Everything is dark. And friends, in a spiritual sense, the blind represent people who cannot see the light. Which light? The light of the world, Jesus Christ. So why does Jesus choose to heal this man in stages? Well, friends, people remember, let's just get the sequence here. People bring this man to Jesus, a blind man, and they say, Lord, please touch him. What does Jesus do next? He takes him by the hand and he leads him outside the town. Then Jesus spits on his eyes, and then the man is partially healed. He sees people as trees walking, and then Jesus touches him again, and he sees clearly. So what's the purpose of the two-stage healing of the blind man? Why? Well, we need to consider what is happening around the time of this healing. What else is taking place in the ministry of Jesus at this very time? What else is happening around this passage in Mark chapter 8, verses 22 to 26? Well, just before the healing of this blind man, Jesus feeds the multitude. Remember, they came to hear him preach? Came toward the end of the day, they hadn't had anything to eat. And Jesus says to his disciples, what are we going to do with all this multitude, all these people? And Jesus said, well, you go and get them something to eat. So what? It's going to take a huge amount of money to feed all these people. How are we going to do it? And you remember the story? The five loaves and the two fishes. How Jesus, can you imagine the disciples? They said, Lord, there are thousands of people here, but Lord, we've got five loaves and two small fish, but realistically, what are they amongst this great crowd? Remember what Jesus does? Prays and feeds everyone from those five loaves and two fishes. Well, when the disciples saw this happening, they thought, yes! You see, the disciples believed that Jesus was here to establish an earthly kingdom. He was going to become an earthly king who would feed everyone. Imagine! Everyone in the nation would be well fed and cared for. He would be a conquering hero. This is the Jesus they wanted. Feed everyone. He would lead the armies. Imagine, he could heal the sick, raise the dead. He would be a military leader who would defeat those hated Romans and drive them out of the country. This is the Messiah they wanted. This is the Jesus they've been waiting for. You see, friends, the disciples were confused about who Jesus really was. They were confused. They couldn't understand that Christ must suffer and be crucified. No, not that! They couldn't come to terms with that. You see, friends, they only partially understood. They couldn't fully and clearly see who Christ was. They see only in part. And so as Jesus hears them discussing who he is, he says to them, do you still not perceive and understand? Just before, he said, do you have eyes and fail to see? Then Jesus healed the blind man in stages. Two stages. At first, his vision is fuzzy and it's confused. Then after a second touch from Jesus, this blind man sees clearly. Friends, this miracle is a parable in action. Jesus was giving the disciples a picture of themselves. A picture of themselves. He was showing them what was happening to them on a spiritual level. The miracle was like a mirror which Jesus was holding up to the disciples. And Jesus was saying to them, now this is where you are. This is your spiritual state today. In this miracle, Jesus was dramatizing the condition of the disciples. Now, friends, immediately after Jesus heals this man, immediately after Jesus heals the blind man, he asks the disciples a critical question. Immediately afterwards, he asked them this question, who do people say that I am? Now, who did the disciples want him to be? They wanted him to be an earthly king, a military hero, give us food to eat, raise the dead, heal the sick, drive the Romans out. That's the Jesus they wanted. So after healing this man in two stages, to show them their own spiritual condition, Jesus says to them, "Hey guys, who are people saying I am?" Do you remember their response? They said, "Oh, some are saying that you're John the Baptist. Others are saying you're Elijah. Still others are saying you are one of the prophets." So they're coming up with all these suggestions that the people are using to identify Jesus. John the Baptist. Elijah. You're Elijah. You're one of the great prophets. And then Jesus looks them straight in the eye. And he says, "Well, what about you? What about you? Who do you say that I am?" And remember Big Mouth Peter? He just blurts out, "You are the Christ." Jesus is making some headway. Remember, their vision is all blurred. They can't see clearly as to who Jesus is in a spiritual sense. Now Peter says, "Well, okay, you are the Christ, not John the Baptist, not Elijah, not one of them. You're the Christ." He says, "You are the Messiah. You are the Son of the living God." But you know, friends, even after he identifies Jesus as the Christ, he's still confused. He still cannot see clearly as to who Jesus really is. How do I know that? Because as soon as he says, "You are the Christ," Jesus begins to explain what the Messiah's mission is. You listen to what Jesus said. He then began to teach. This is immediately after Peter says, "You are the Christ." Then Jesus began to teach them that the Son of Man, notice, that he must suffer many things. Shocking. And then even more shocking, he says, and that he must be killed. Oh no, Lord. Then he spoke plainly about this. He's describing his mission to them, what it means if he is the Christ. Remember what Peter did? Peter said, "Lord, just hold on a minute. I need to take you aside here. Come with me, Jesus." And Peter, it says, no. And Peter took him aside and began to what? Rebuke him. He said, "Lord, don't you talk nonsense about being killed and having to suffer and die. That's nonsense." He still didn't. He did not get it. He still wanted an earthly king. So he takes Jesus aside and he rebukes him. You see, friends, Peter and the other disciples couldn't see that Jesus had to die on the cross. Why? They still wanted an earthly king who would make them famous and wealthy. That's what they wanted. They wanted to get pally-pally. They wanted to be close to Jesus. They wanted to be part of his group, part of his team. Why? So they could be famous. So they could be wealthy. They wanted to be part of this earthly kingdom. They wanted to be part of the inner circle. Thank you. How do I know that? Because right next to this text, notice what happens next. It says, "Then they came to Capernaum. And when he was in the house, he asked them, 'What were you arguing about on the road?'" So friends, get the picture here. Jesus is with the disciples. He's making his way to Jerusalem. What's going to happen in Jerusalem? What's going to happen in Jerusalem?
He's going to die.
He's going to die. He's going to be crucified. So as they start this road trip together, they've got visions of grandeur. Look at this guy that we're with. This Jesus. He can feed thousands of people from five loaves and two fishes. He can raise the dead. He can heal the sick. And this is the kingdom we want to be part of. Jesus is on his way to Calvary. They think he's on his way with them in tow to establish his kingdom in Jerusalem. And Jesus has to prepare them. He's got to get them ready for what is going to come. And so as he travels with them, he's trying to explain to them what it's all about. And the miracles and the events that happen on the way to Jerusalem, Jesus is using to prepare the disciples for what's going to happen when they get to Jerusalem. And so as they're traveling along, they come to Capernaum after all this has happened, immediately, as they're traveling together. When he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the road on the way here?" Listen to the next text. But they kept quiet. They didn't answer. Why? Because on the way they had argued about what? About what?
Who's
going to be the greatest in this kingdom that Jesus is going to set up? You know, where do I fit in here? I'm an important person. I'm going for the top job. Friends, they were human and they had egos. Dare I say it? Just like each of us.
Louder.
Just like each of us. They wanted to be the top. The big deal. The one who gives all the orders. So notice what Jesus does. Can you imagine the frustration? Can you imagine poor Jesus? He says, "Please just sit down now. Listen." Sitting down, Jesus called the 12. He called them around and he said, "If anyone wants to be first, he must be the very last." And what?
Servant.
And the servant. Friends, Jesus is trying to explain who he is so that they can begin to realize who they are and what their role is. The disciples are still confused. They cannot see clearly who Jesus really is. And so as they travel to Jerusalem, Jesus is teaching them. He's explaining his mission to them as they carry out this journey together. And Jesus is using his miracles and the experiences along the way to teach the disciples so that their eyes are opened and they can clearly see who he really is. Notice what happens next. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him, fell on his knees before him, and said, "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to have eternal life?" It's a good question, isn't it? Good question. Notice what Jesus says. Jesus answered, "You know the commandments. Do not murder, do not commit adultery, do not steal." And notice his response. He said, "Teacher, oh, don't worry. I've done all these things since I was a boy." It's okay, Jesus. I'm in. I've been doing all this for as long as I can remember. Jesus looked at him and loved him. And then Jesus says, "But there's one thing you lack. Just one thing." He said, "Go sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and what? Then come and
follow
me." Now, friends, what were the disciples doing? What were the disciples doing? They were following Jesus. Isn't that right? That's what a disciple is. So Jesus is now explaining to them as he talks to the rich young ruler. Jesus has a message for the disciples. He says, "Go sell all you have." Now they want plenty of the earthly good things, like us. They want the material possessions. They want to be wealthy like the rich young ruler. And Jesus says to him, listen, you just lack one thing. And remember, Jesus loved him. He looked at him and he saw someone special in this young man. And he says to him, look, there's just one thing you lack. Just one thing you've got to do. Go and sell everything you have. You're going to have treasure in heaven then. And you come and follow me. Like these other guys here, these other 12. Do you remember the rich young ruler's response? Notice. At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad. Why? Because he had great wealth. That's what it says next. As that young man walked away and said, Lord, hey, don't mess with my wealth. I'll do everything else, but not the wealth, please. What did the disciples want? They wanted to be big deals. They wanted to be famous. They wanted to be leaders in this kingdom. They wanted earthly wealth. And as that young man walked away, then Jesus turned to his disciples. He looked around and he said to his disciples, how hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God. You follow?
Yeah.
There's a message there, my friends, for the disciples as well. But friends, even after all this, the disciples still didn't get it. They couldn't see Jesus for who he really was. They couldn't understand what it means to be a true disciple of Jesus. They wanted the power. They wanted the wealth. They wanted the glory. They wanted the things, the material things of this earth. Then James, as you read through this passage, it's just amazing how slow the disciples were to get it. As they continue, after all of this, as they continue on the way up to Jerusalem, notice what the Bible says. Then James and John came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. So the two brothers get Jesus aside and they say, listen, Jesus, just James and me, we want you to do for us whatever we ask, will you? Notice what Jesus says. Now I want you to notice this. Jesus says, what do you want me to do for you? He asks. So as I say, listen, Lord, we want you to do whatever. He says, okay, what is it? What do you want me to do for you? Remember that question. Because Jesus asked it twice. This is the first time. What do you want me to do for you? Here's their response. They replied, look, Lord, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. Had they learned anything? Do you think they saw Jesus clearly yet? After all this. They're on their way to Jerusalem. They still want Jesus to drive out the Romans, set up an earthly kingdom, and guess who's going to sit on the right and on the left?
Peter and James.
Exactly right. Lord, we want the big position. So Lord, do whatever we ask. I want to sit on the right, and my brother here, he wants to sit on the left. What did they learn?
Nothing.
What did they learn? So, Jesus gathers them all together again. And I want you to listen to what he says. Whoever wants to become great among you must be your what?
Servant.
Must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be what?
Slave
of all. And then he says it again. Listen. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve. And here he hits it on the head again. And to give his life as a ransom for many. Fine. finally, the disciples begin to get it. Finally, they get it and they see clearly who Jesus is and what it means to follow him. And so, friends, back to our miracle. Remember, Jesus heals that blind man from Bethsaida. He heals him in stages. And friends, the two-stage healing of the blind man that immediately followed the disciples' confusion as to the identity of Jesus was to show them their own spiritual blindness. Because of their confusion about the mission and the identity of Jesus, the disciples didn't see and understand clearly. What did they need? A second touch. They needed a second touch. Like the blind man. The disciples couldn't see who Jesus really was. They didn't understand his mission. They didn't get it again and again. Like the blind man, they needed to have their sight fully restored. You see, friends, the disciples needed to see that Jesus and his mission can only be understood in the light of his death on the cross. So here we have this sequence of events. Just notice them with me. We have first, Jesus heals the 5,000. The disciples want an earthly king with a powerful kingdom. They want the power, they want the glory, they want all that goes with the material possessions that come with a mighty empire. That's what they want. They're confused. So then Jesus rebukes the disciples, remember? Then comes the two-part healing of the blind man. And then straight after that, Peter rightly declares, Jesus says, well, who do people say that I am? Okay, John the Baptist, Elijah, one of the prophets. Then he says straight to them, who do you say that I am? Peter pipes up, you are the Christ. But he still didn't get it. And so Jesus has to explain his mission some more. Now the disciples can see clearly. And you know what Jesus does? He heals another blind man. He heals another blind man. He performs this time not a two-part healing, but a one-time healing of blind Bartimaeus in Jericho, just before they begin the climb. I want to read it to you. Notice what it says. And he went out of Jericho with his disciples, and a great multitude. Blind Bartimaeus sat by the road begging. And Jesus stopped and said, call him. Can you imagine? He's calling out, are you the son of David there? I can't see you, but others are telling me you're in town. Is that you there? Heal me. Make me well. And Jesus stops. Can you imagine the excitement? Jesus said, bring him over. Call him. They bring him over. And I want you to notice what Jesus asked him. Here it is. Here it's supposed to be. He said to the blind man, what do you want me to do for you? Remember that same question? He asked that same question to John and James, remember? They said, Lord, will you do whatever we want for you? What do you want me to do for you? Oh, we want to be right up the front. We want to be the most important people in your kingdom. Now he asked the blind man that same question. And the blind man said, what? Rabbi, I just want to see. That's it. I just want to see. And you know, friends, when he said that, then Jesus said to him, go your way, your faith has made you well. And immediately, what did he receive? His sight. Now the disciples get it. They understand the mission of Jesus. And they can see it. They can see it in the events surrounding the miracle of this, the healing of this blind man. Jesus says, "What can I do for you? You're calling out. What do you want me to do for you?" He said, "Lord, I just want to see." That's it. And Jesus heals him immediately. And so, friends, Jesus uses these two miracles of healing blind men to teach his disciples a lesson about his identity and his mission. The two-stage healing of the blind man at Bethsaida was to show the disciples that they didn't see clearly who Jesus was. And then the first time healing of Bartimaeus at Jericho indicated that after Peter rightly declares, "You are the Christ," and Jesus begins to explain what that means, they finally get it. The disciples had a clearer view of who Jesus really was. But now, friends, Jesus' question comes to you and to me. But what about you? Who do you say that I am? How's your vision, friends? How's your vision? Who is Jesus to you? Is he a Santa Claus who you come to when you need more money in your bank account? Oh Lord, I need a bigger car. Please. I need a BMW. You know how badly I need it, Lord. Or when we get sick, hey Lord, please, heal me. I need a new job. Friends, who is Jesus to you? Is he the Christ, the crucified Messiah? And what does that mean for your discipleship? What are you seeking in life? When Jesus says to you, "Well, what can I do for you? What do you want me to do for you?" Friends, what are we wanting to do for us? What do we want Jesus to do for us? How clearly do we see Jesus? It was brought home to me just this last week in such a vivid and graphic way. Last week we went to Brisbane to bury Robin's dad. Big man, 6'4" he was. He was a horse breaker and a drover, and he wanted to be a medical missionary. So he went to Avondale, then he went to the Sands, studied to be a minister, studied to be a nurse. And God answered his prayer. Sent him off to a place you've never heard of. Kalimpong. Bet you don't know where that is. Well, let me tell you where it is. It's situated right up the north of India in a little piece of land that is surrounded by Nepal on the left, Tibet to the north, and Bhutan to the right, to the east. A medical missionary there. Fortunately, before he went, the boat was delayed for 3 months. And so one of the dentists here in Sydney took him aside and said, "Man, you better learn how to pull teeth." Gave him a crash course in dentistry. You know, friends, as a dentist, he served the family of the leader of Tibet, the Dalai Lama of Tibet. The Dalai Lama was so grateful for what he did that he gave him one of his own outfits. It's his pride and joy. He also pulled out the teeth of the Queen of Bhutan. Medical missionary, that's what he wanted to be. Came back to Australia, served the church in a number of significant leadership roles. You know, friends, last Monday, it was my job to dispose of his last possessions. They were in a dozen plastic bags. After nearly 90 years on this planet, that was it. That was it. I took them down to the local ADRA bin. Stuffed them in the bin. I thought to myself, is this what life's all about? We come to the end of our days and
there it is in a few bags. Then I remembered. One of the last things he said to me was, Gary, on my headstone, I want just two words. Three words. Asleep in Jesus. That's it. That's it. And my friend, that's what it means to see Jesus again. If you can accept Jesus as the crucified Christ, the one who died for your sins, so that you can live forever. And if you should not live to see Jesus come, but you can have that written on your headstone, asleep in Jesus, then you've seen it all. You've seen clearly. And you will live forever. Not the material possessions, friends. Where do they go? They end up in the Adrabin. It's your vision, your relationship with Jesus. It's the only thing that matters. And it is my prayer, friend, that each one of us here will be ready to meet Jesus when he comes. Amen. Because we've seen him clearly here and now. And we will live with him forever. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to see Jesus clearly. When you ask us, who do you say that I am? We respond, you are the Christ, the crucified Lord. You are our Savior. Through you our sins can be forgiven, no matter what mistakes we have made. Lord, may we see you clearly. And may each one of us here be found ready and waiting to meet Jesus when he comes. For this is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. I think we're going to have another special item now.
I think so.
And it's such a beauty. Are we ready? You're going to like this. It's a perfect lyrics, perfect words, perfect music. And I know it's going to be beautifully presented for our subject today. Thank you very much. Father, that's the question. Are we ready for Jesus to come? And Father, again, it is my prayer that each one of us here will see you clearly, will love you more dearly, and be ready to meet Jesus when he comes. Grant us that privilege and come soon, Lord Jesus, we pray. Amen.